Hello everyone and welcome back to Easy Dentistry, a channel that makes learning incredibly easy. With COVID-19 around, everyone is talking about immunity. So in our microbiology lecture series, I am uploading a lecture on immunity, which is a very important topic from exam point of view. Many questions are asked from this topic in your UG exams, in your entrance exams. So let's simplify immunity. So first, in this lecture, we will be studying the basic concepts of immunity in two parts, part 1 and part 2. So in this part 1 lecture, we will be talking about the innate immunity. Now, what would we be talking about innate immunity? We would be talking about the types of innate immunity, the factors influencing innate immunity, and the mechanism of innate immunity. Now, how do we define immunity? Immunity is the resistance exhibited by the host against any foreign antigen, including microorganisms. So, if this is a host and this is a foreign antigen or a microorganism infecting the host, then the resistance shown by the host against this infectious agent is called as the immunity. Now, what is the role of this immunity? Immunity functions in prevention of infectious diseases. Now, immunity is of two types, the innate immunity and the acquired immunity. The word innate means inborn, or the inborn immunity in an individual, while the acquired immunity is developed by an individual. So the inborn immunity or the innate immunity are again of three types: the species immunity, racial immunity, and individual immunity. While the acquired immunity is of two types, active acquired immunity and passive acquired immunity. Now, let us study this innate or the inborn immunity in detail. First, the types of innate immunity. First type is the species immunity. Species immunity, as the name implies, it is the resistance to a pathogen shown by all the members of a species. So the entire species is immune to the pathogen. Example, the bacillus anthracis infects human beings, but it cannot infect the chickens. So the entire species of the chicken is having species immunity against bacillus anthracis. Now, what is the mechanism of this species immunity is not well understood, but probably the difference in the physiological and the biochemical composition between the tissues of different species is responsible for this species specific immunity. Now, the second type of innate immunity is the racial immunity. Now, the species are made up of different races. For example, race 1, race 2, and so on. So, resistance to a pathogen exhibited by a particular race of a species is called as the racial immunity. So, in a particular species, if there are various races, if a specific race, for example, a race called as race 2 is having resistance to a pathogen, so it can be said that there is racial immunity in this particular race against a particular pathogen. For example, in the race sheep, in the species sheep, the Algerian sheep has a high resistance to anthrax. So the race of the Algerian sheep is immune against the anthrax bacilli, while other races of the sheep are commonly infected by anthrax. Now, the mechanism of this racial immunity is mostly genetic. Now, for an example, humans In humans, those races with sickle cell anemia are immune to Plasmodium falciparum infection. This is because in sickle cell anemia, there is genetic abnormality in the erythrocytes. So, these abnormal erythrocytes cannot be parasitized by Plasmodium falciparum. So, sickle cell anemia patients show immunity to Plasmodium falciparum infection. Also, humans with G6PD deficiency are also resistant to Plasmodium falciparum infection. Now, the third type of innate immunity is the individual immunity, in which a particular individuals in a race are resistant to an infection. Now, the cause of this is also genetic. Now, let us study the factors affecting the innate immunity. There are three factors which affect the innate immunity. This is the age, the hormones, and the nutrition level. Now, let us study how these factors modify the innate immunity. First, the age. Talking about the age, the extremes of age have a susceptibility to infection. That is, when the fetus have a very compromised immunity or an immature immunity, while people at older age have a waning immunity. So, at these extremes of age, the immunity is low and there is increased susceptibility to infections. Now, also, the fetus is protected from maternal infections by the placental barrier, but certain infections like rubella, cytomegalovirus and toxoplasma can cross this placental barrier and infect the fetus, causing congenital malformations. Also to note here, chickenpox and poliomyelitis infection show severe clinical manifestation in adults because the adults have an active immune response, and this active immune response causes increased tissue damage. Now, second factor modifying the innate immunity is the hormones. Hormonal conditions such as diabetes mellitus, adrenal dysfunction and hypothyroidism are the conditions in which there is increased susceptibility to infection. In diabetes, there is increased amount of carbohydrates in the tissue, and this increases the staphylococcal sepsis level. Corticosteroids have a property of anti-inflammatory, anti-phagocytic and reduction in the antibody formation, and so intake of corticosteroids reduces the host resistance. Thirdly, pregnancy is a condition in which there is increased steroid level, and this increased steroid level increases the susceptibility to infection. The third factor which modifies the innate immunity is the nutrition. Malnutrition increases the susceptibility to bacterial infections because of reduced humoral and cell-mediated immunity. Now, let us study the mechanism of innate immunity. There are three mechanisms of innate immunity: the epithelial surfaces, antibacterial substances, cellular factors, inflammation, and fever. Let us study each in detail. The epithelial surfaces provide innate immunity. These epithelial surfaces may be skin, the epithelium of the respiratory tract, the epithelium of the GI tract, conjunctiva, or the genitourinary tract epithelium. Now, talking about the skin, it acts as a mechanical barrier to the infectious agents. Also, certain bactericidal secretions are secreted by the skin, like the salt present in the sweat is bactericidal. The sebaceous gland secretions also contain bactericidal property, and the long chain fatty acids present in the skin secretion also acts as bactericidal. Now, the flora present on the skin, the microbes which are present on the skin also prevent the infection. There are two types of skin flora, the resident skin flora and the transient skin flora. Now this resident skin flora, it prevents the colonization of the pathogens. Alteration of this resident normal flora of the skin causes invasion of extraneous microbes into the skin, resulting into disease. Now, the respiratory tract is made up of moist mucous membrane, and this moist mucous membrane, it entraps the foreign particles. So, this mucus secretions present on the nasal epithelium or the respiratory tract epithelium helps in entrapping the foreign particles. Now, the hair-like cilia present in the respiratory epithelium, it propels the particle towards the pharynx, and from the pharynx, these particles may be swallowed or coughed out. Now, coughing reflex is also an important defense mechanism. Some of the dirt particles or the foreign particles, if they reach the alveoli of the lungs, they are attacked by the phagocytes. Now, the intestinal tract, firstly, the saliva present in the mouth has many inhibitory effects on the microbes. Then, the gastric juices have an acidic pH which kill the microbes. Now, the normal intestinal flora has a protective effect and it prevents the colonization of pathogenic bacteria. Now, the conjunctiva, the tears present in the eyes help in flushing the dirt and bacteria. Also, the tears contain lysozymes which have antibacterial effect. Now, the genitourinary tract, urine has a flushing action which eliminates the bacteria from the urethra. Now, the vaginal secretions have acidic pH, and so it keeps the vagina free of all pathogens. And the semen is also shown to have certain antibacterial substances. Now, the second mechanism of this innate immunity is the secretion of the antibacterial substances. There are certain non-specific antibacterial substances present in the tissues, which include properidin, complement, lysozymes, beta lysates and interferons. We will be having a separate lecture on complement. So, we will be studying complement in detail later. Then, the cellular factors responsible for the innate immunity are very important. Once the infective agent crosses the epithelial barrier, the cellular factors of the mechanism of innate immunity comes into play. Now, when the infectious agent attacks the tissue, there is exudative inflammatory reaction in the tissue, and there may be activation of phagocytes, or in the tissue there is fibrin formation, and this fibrin, it entangles the organisms and removes it. Now, the phagocytes which are activated because of this infectious agent are of two types: the microphages and the macrophages. The microphages are polymorphonuclear leukocytes or the neutrophils, while the macrophages are the mononuclear cells. Now, these phagocytes act in four stages. First stage is the chemotaxis, then comes the attachment, then comes the ingestion, and finally the intracellular killing. In the first step or the chemotaxis stage, the phagocytes, they reach the site of infection, and they are at the site of infection, there is release of certain chemotactic substances, and these phagocytes are attracted to this chemotactic substances, and this movement of the phagocytes in the direction of these chemotactic substances is called as chemotaxis. So in the second step, the infectious agent
it gets attached to the phagocytic membrane. So here you can see this bacteria, it is getting attached to this phagocytic membrane. In the third stage, there is ingestion. The phagocyte, it engulfs the infective agent. So here you can see the infective agent, this red colored bacteria, is engulfed inside the phagocyte with the formation of a vacuole. Now, this phagosome or the vacuole which engulfs the foreign particle, it fuses with the lysosome present in the phagocyte to form the phagolysosome. Now, the final step of phagocytosis occurs inside this phagolysosome, in which intracellular killing occurs. In this phagolysosome, there is release of certain hydrolytic enzymes, and these hydrolytic enzymes, they destruct or destroy the infective agents. So these are the four stages of phagocytosis: the chemotaxis, attachment, ingestion, and intracellular killing. There are certain exceptions like mycobacteria and mycobacterium tuberculosis and mycobacterium leprae, which resist killing inside the phagolysosome. Instead of that, these two bacteria, they multiply within the phagolysosome and cause dissemination of the infection. Also, there are certain natural killer cells or the NK cells which have non-specific defense against the viral infections. Now, the fourth mechanism of innate immunity is the inflammation. In inflammation, there is vasodilation, increased vascular permeability, and increased cellular infiltration. Now, this increased cellular infiltration causes phagocytosis. Increased vascular permeability at the site of inflammation causes outpouring of the plasma, and this dilutes the toxic products. Also, at the site of inflammation, there is fibrin barrier formation, which acts in innate immunity. The fifth mechanism of innate immunity is fever. Infection causes increase in the body temperature, and this fever is a natural defense mechanism of the body. Now, the fever, it destroys the pathogen inside the body, and it causes interferon release, which helps in the recovery from the viral infections. The sixth important factor or the mechanism for innate immunity is the acute phase proteins. After infection or any injury, there is release of acute phase proteins. These acute phase proteins are the C-reactive proteins and the mammose binding proteins. The C-reactive proteins, it activates the alternate pathway of complement. I again repeat, we will be having a separate lecture on complement. So, where we will be studying this alternate pathway of complement. Now, these C-reactive proteins, they prevent the tissue injury and it promote the tissue repair. So, here we complete with the lecture on innate immunity. If you have any doubts, please comment below in the comment box. The next lecture will be on acquired immunity. That's all for now. Please subscribe to our channel if you have not yet done. Happy studying!